Anne arrived at Pelsall, fresh-faced and eager to serve in whatever way he could. 2 years later, he's still fresh-faced and eager to serve and be involved in church life. Tim would often say that we've been spoilt in a way with having someone who is keen and willing to please, eager to serve, and just gets on with it. Over the last 2 years, Dan has behind the scenes been doing a remote theological course run by Edinburgh Theological Course, and has always received excellent marks in his studies, although he'd be far too modest to tell you. He has a few more years of studies to do to complete his degree. As I mentioned, he's been willing to throw himself into church life. He's been involved with Discoverers 116 and the Disciple Group throughout the last 2 years, not to mention the Holiday Bible Club, where for 2 years running, he's managed to go beyond the call of duty and get gunged. He's been a regular at Coffee Morning and the community space, being faithful in both attending and leading home groups and prayer meetings. And as he'll be doing this morning, he's preached God's word, not only to us, but to other churches in the locality. And he's even been invited back to some of them. I'm sure, like me, you've seen how Dan has grown in character in his preaching and as a person over the last 2 years as God has led him and worked in his life. I'm sure you'll forgive me for saying something on a personal note. On behalf of my wife Julia and I, that was the start of another speech I made recently. Yes, about 18 months ago, Dan started dating my youngest daughter, Isabella, with them getting married in March this year, for which I'll be eternally grateful to Dan. But seriously, it's been a pleasure to have Dan as a son-in-law. He's even helped me with some DIY projects. Anyway, you may ask, what's next for Dan and Izzy? Well, for the next 12 months, they'll be staying in Pelsall. Izzy's doing a second of 2 years ECT training at Leeds with primary school, and Dan will be continuing his theological studies on a part-time basis while engaging in some part-time work as they wait upon the Lord to see what he has in store for them. Medium term, Dan's seeking ministry work as an assistant pastor while finishing his studies. So please continue to pray for the continued leading of the Lord in both of their lives. So I have got just a small token of our appreciation. I don't know what you buy for the man who's got everything, but so I've got him a gift card. So Dan, step forward. So there's a gift card. So thank you very much for your service over the last.
Thank you.
So I have got a card as well, which I'll leave on the table at the front. So as many as possible, if you could sign that, that would be really appreciated by Dan. So that'd be good. So let us just pray for Dan as he continues. So shall we just pray? Father, we thank you for Dan and how you have led him during this role as a ministry trainee over the last 2 years. We thank you how he's been encouragement to your people here at Pelsall and other local churches. We thank you for his willingness to be involved in church life, working with the children and young people, preaching your word and leading services. Father, we pray for him as he waits upon your direction for future ministry work. We thank you that you know all our paths and all our lives are mapped out before us, so we can be assured of what you have ahead of us. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for that, and thank you everybody for the year, 2 years that I've had. It's been an honour and a privilege to serve here at the church with you all, so I'd be forever thankful for you all for that, and thankful for God for bringing me here, so thank you everyone. So we're here to worship, so let's hear from God's word. Psalm 146 verse 6 says, "He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever." This morning we've come together to worship God, the God of heaven. He is the faithful God who we serve. He's the one who saved us and delivered us from all our sins. He has given us his Son and made us right before him. We are here to worship him because he is good, he is faithful, and he deserves all our worship. So let's start by singing about God's faithfulness. Please stand as we sing, "Great is thy faithfulness." Going to pray, and that's going to be led by Steve.
Let us pray. Loving God, our refuge and our fortress, the one in whom we can trust, your ways are holy, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. All things were created through you and by you. You who formed the planets and stars, you who formed us in our mother's womb, know everything about us, even the number of hairs on our head. We see your handiwork in the beauty of your creation and marvel at your mighty works. We see you at work in the lives of those around us when we witness compassion, healing, forgiveness, free will giving, unselfish love, humility, truth, and justice. You rescue us from the snares of evil and show us the path to righteousness. How great is our God. Father, for those times when we let you down, moments when we allow the temptation of the evil one to prevail, moments when we made the wrong choices, times when we missed opportunities to show your love in the things that we say or do. For all those times when we let you down, we are truly sorry. We thank you for your word, given through the writings of your prophets and inspired by you, which help us to know and to love you as you deserve. We give thanks for the work in our church, including the setting up and the operation for the Holiday Bible Club. For all those whose hard work and participation made it such a success in teaching others about you. We thank you for them and pray that the lessons learned and that the messages given will in turn inspire more people to come to know more about you and the deep love you have for us. We give you thanks and praise for your constant love. You care for your children and are always ready to hear us. We pray for our brother Norman Ellis, who is still currently in hospital, that the search for a nursing home will have a good outcome and that Norman will find the rest, peace and care in aiding the return of his rationality and confusion. We thank you, Lord, for the care that Doreen has and pray for them both as they come to terms with the new situation that they find themselves in. Loving God, we are mindful of John and Jane's daughter, Sarah Craddock, who has suffered from COVID. Lord, we pray for healing in her recovery period, that she might know your presence with her at this time and pray that she will be restored to full health in the weeks ahead. We also pray for John and Jane in their support for Sarah, that you will give them signs of encouragement and comfort in the weeks ahead. We pray too for our sister Celia, that she may feel your presence and peace at this time in her respite care. Our thoughts and prayers are also for Nicola Healy and her family, that her mother will cope with her father's sudden dramatic downturn in health until she returns on Wednesday. Father, we ask for your help in the lives of those here this morning, especially those who petition you with their difficulties or challenges. We pray for your love, support, and care to help them in the days and months ahead. Help them to know that you are there for them. We ask for your care too and protection for all those who serve you especially those who are persecuted because of it. May you be with them in their need of you, to uphold, comfort and reassure them, in knowing that they are yours. Loving God, we thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives, whose presence lifts us and encourages us in our work for you. And finally, we thank you for the gift of your only Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, a part of you, whose life was given as an atonement for our sins, showing your deep love for us. His sacrifice has brought us life and defeated death, a debt we can never repay. We humbly ask these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So in our passage later on, as we look at God's word, we'll be looking at suffering and God's sovereignty. But next, we're going to sing and remind ourselves of God's sovereign hand, that he's the good Father working for our good and his glory. So let's come together and stand and sing Sovereign Over Us. So please stand as we sing together.
Thank you.
We're now going to have a Bible reading. That's from 1 Peter chapter 5. I'm reading from verses 5 to 11. In the Church Bible, that's page number 1220. And in the larger print, it's page number 1892. So that's 1 Peter chapter 5, and reading from verse 5. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power for ever and ever. Amen. So we have a God who cares for us. He cares for us in our sufferings, and we can always go to him. Whatever we're going through, he's there for us to help us. And one day God will call time on this earth, and all our sufferings and struggles will be gone. And we can remind each other this as we sing, Jesus, strong and kind. So let's continue in worship as we sing, Jesus, strong and kind.
Oh,
We're now going to come and look at God's word, so please turn in your Bible to Ruth chapter 1. And in the church Bible, that's page number 267. And in the larger print, that's page number 408. So Ruth chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. So a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, his wife's name was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died. And Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. When Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, she and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show you kindness as you have shown kindness to your dead husbands and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they wept aloud and said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Return home, my daughters. I am too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to sons, would you wait until they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has turned against me." At this, they wept aloud again. Then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her." But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me." When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. So the two women went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them, and the women exclaimed, "Can this be Naomi?" "Don't call me Naomi," she told them. "Call me Mara, because the Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi? The Lord has afflicted me. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me." So Naomi returned from Moab, accompanied by Ruth, the Moabite, her daughter-in-law. Arriving in Bethlehem as the barley harvest was beginning. This is God's word. So let's start with a little bit of insight into the book of Ruth. The book of Ruth is all about redemption, about God raising up a redeemer in the bleak times. The book of Ruth was set in the time of the judges. And if you flick back in your Bibles to the book Judges, you'll see bleak and hopeless times. You'll see a people who did what was right in their own eyes. This is the time when God is ignored and people do as they please. It was set in the time of the judges, but it was not written then. The first hearers of the book were a people much later on. We see evidence for that in Ruth chapter 4 with King David being mentioned. And also what is said in chapter 4, verse 7, the author telling us what the customs were in previous times. The first hearers of the book of Ruth were a people in a bleak time, somewhere in between the 12 tribes split and the post-exile era, which is the decline of Israel. The first hearers of the book of Ruth were to read this book and think, just as God raised up a redeemer here, in the bleak time of the judges, he raised up Boaz, and through Boaz, he raised up King David. Just as God did this, God will raise up a redeemer again in the future, and a much greater redeemer. Those in Israel in a bleak time can look back and think, God raised up a redeemer before, therefore we can trust God to do it again. So that's a little bit about what the book is about. But what about chapter 1? We see in verses 1 to 5, faithless fleeing, verses 1 to 5. The book Pilgrim's Progress is about the journey of the Christian life, all the joys and the struggles that we have in this life while we walk with Jesus, and the continual need to keep going. Early on in the book, the main character, called Christian, is saved, and he starts his journey on the road, and he meets a man named Pliable. Pliable is interested in all the eternal joy and the kingdom to come, but as they go along the road, they come into difficulty. And Pliable, he sees the difficulty, and he decides, the Christian journey is not for me. He turns back, he recognizes the struggle, and he wants to be free from that. As we enter verses 1 to 5, we meet Elimelech, who is a similar sort of character to Pliable. Let's look at what makes him leave God's land, leave following God's way. Notice verse 1, we see two problems that escalate. It goes from bad to worse. Firstly, as we said, it's the time of the judges. This time was when in Israel men did what they wanted. It was especially a time where women were not safe to be alone. Women were abused and taken advantage of in these times. The judges' time were a time where people continually rebelled against God. But notice the second problem. There's a famine in the land. Famine in Bethlehem. The word Bethlehem means house of bread, but there's a famine in the land. What can we say about famine? It's not always a sign of judgment, but God, through Moses, said about his people, if they choose to disobey his commands and follow idols, Deuteronomy 11, 17 says, then the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will shut up the heavens so that it will not rain, and the ground will yield no produce, and you will soon perish from the good land the Lord has given you. Under the terms of the Old Covenant before Jesus, when God's people started to try and live without him, God often awakened them by sending famine on the land. Going without sufficient food is often a way that gets our attention. Here in the Judges' time, we have great evidence that God sent a famine to call his people to repentance. But what does Elimelech do? He doesn't repent and call out to God. Notice verse 2, he goes to Moab. Moab of all places. But what is so bad about Moab? Moab is the place of God's enemies. Moab was known for its child sacrifices, its sexual immorality, and its idol worship. And this is where Elimelech decides to take his family. Moab was a place where God's people went and disobeyed God. The Moabites deceived and seduced Israel into idol worship and sexual sin. And this is where Elimelech, he decides to take his family. He turns his back on God's promised land and he faithlessly flees to escape difficulty. Elimelech's disobedience is better understood again through the context of the times back then. In the Old Testament, God's blessings were situated in one location, and God wanted his people to stick to the land that he had given them. So when Elimelech decided to move from Moab, he wasn't just moving house, but he was departing from God. By his action, he was leaving God and going to live with God's enemies. In Israel, it was supposed to be God's people in God's land under God's rule and blessing. Therefore, as Elimelech left Bethlehem, he abandoned his God. This is disobedience. The name Elimelech means "my God is king." But Elimelech, he decides he knows best. I will go and sort this out. Elimelech saw the grass was greener on the other side. He saw Moab and he thought, I'll go over there and we'll have food to eat. Elimelech, he comes into difficulty and he opts for the easy way out. He chooses his own way instead of God's way. He does what people do in the time of the judges. He did what seemed right in his own eyes. Well, what happens to Elimelech as he goes to Moab? We see this in verses 3 to 5. He dies. Then after that, his two sons, they marry Moabite women, which again is an act of disobedience. So we have Ruth married to Mahlon and Orpah married to Chilion. Then it gets even worse. Mahlon and Chilion die. Therefore, we end verse 5 with Naomi, Ruth, and Orpah. There is no male in the family. This is a disaster. Back in these times, women needed a male. They wouldn't be safe without a man. They were dependent on their husbands to provide for them, protect them, give them security. But verse 5 leaves these three women in desperate need. Verses 1 to 5, it doesn't tell us that these men died because of their sin. God does sometimes strike people down in the Bible because of their sin, but we cannot see this in these verses. But what we do know is that all three of these men, they all disobeyed God. Elimelech, he took his family and himself away from God, and Mahlon and Chilion chose to marry foreign women who worshipped idols. But what can we in the 21st century, what can we learn from verses 1 to 5? Today, as Christians, we are under God's new covenant, which are God's promises and blessings to his people who have faith in Jesus Christ. God's blessings are no longer in a location, but they are in a person. All God's promises are there for us in Jesus Christ. But just as Elimelech, he had Moab to tempt him away from God's blessing, we as Christians today have many Moabs all around us. We have this world we live in tempting us to leave God's way, stop doing what God wants, and come and have pleasure. Some of our Moabs may be sexual sin, some may be greed, some may be gossip, some are selfishness, and others, they pull us away every day. Let me tell you this morning, Moab may look good, Moab may promise much, but notice what Moab leads to. Moab leads to death. I wonder today, what is your Moab? What is the sin you leave God for? Where do you go to where you know you shouldn't? I want to urge us all, myself including, don't go to Moab. Hold firm onto Jesus. Hold firm onto his promises. Whatever we're going through, Moab may look good, but Jesus is better. Make it your resolve each morning to tell yourself, today I'm going to live God's way, whatever that might mean, and I'm going to do it by faith because I know that that's what's best. So let's continue with the narrative. We leave verse 5. These three women, they're vulnerable, they're in danger, they are without their husbands. Remember, it's the time of the judges when women are not safe. What will happen next? These three women are in Moab. Naomi, she's away from her home. But will these women stay together in Moab? How will they be kept safe? Let's think as we go into verses 6 to 18. Costly commitment. Verses 6 to 18. Costly commitment. I wonder what Naomi would be feeling right now. She's just lost her husband and then her two sons. She's experienced pain through death. Imagine that. Maybe it's not too hard for you to imagine. Just think about Naomi's pain and heartbreak. How would Naomi be feeling? She'd be feeling as if nothing could get any worse. And we're told in verse 6 that Naomi decides to go back to Judah. She hears that the Lord has brought about food for his people. Just picture the scene. These women, they've been through so much pain and grief. And then Naomi, she decides that she's going to go back to Judah. And as they're walking on the road together, Naomi tells them, no, go back. Go back to Moab. Then Naomi says, may the Lord show you kindness. And may the Lord grant you to find rest in the home of another husband. And then in verses 9 and 10, Naomi kissed them goodbye. But these two Moabite women say, no, we'll go back with you to your people. Notice this, they both commit to going with Naomi and supporting her. In fact, they probably know that they are Naomi's only hope. Naomi has no offspring. The line of Elimelech is going to cease. And then we get to the point in verses 11 to 13. Naomi tells them what it'd be like if they come back with her. Naomi tells them, you'll have nothing. There's no husband for you, so no protection, no security. If they go with Naomi, they'll have no inheritance, no family, and no offspring. Since back in these times, the inheritance only went through the sons. And if they went with Naomi, they'd need to marry a close relative of Naomi so that the line of Elimelech would carry on. What Naomi tells them in verses 11 to 13 is, if you come with me, you'll get what I've got. You'll just be like me. There's no hope for you. There's no hope for you to have a husband if you come with me. Naomi, in her grief, she gives up hope. She doesn't think there's any other males in her family that can carry on the line. And after hearing this, Orpah, what does she do? She's heard enough. She does what Elimelech does. She opts for the safe option. Orpah chooses comfort and ease over going with her mother-in-law. And we may think Orpah did the right thing. She made a wise decision. And on the surface, maybe it looks like she did. Orpah is a picture of an almost Christian. Someone who knows that it is right. Someone who knows that it's the right way of life, but someone who doesn't want to fully commit. Orpah knew it was right to go with her mother-in-law, but she saw the cost. She didn't want to commit because she saw the life in Moab was easier. And that's what many do today. They see that being a Christian is the right way of life, but they just don't want to fully commit. Some people even start on the path like Orpah. They come and say they believe, but they soon turn away. They want the easy way. They don't want to commit because it may be hard. If that's you today, don't do what Orpah did. Don't choose the easy way. Commit to the Lord Jesus today. Coming to Christ is costly. It does cost your life, but the alternative is even more costly. Rejecting Jesus costs you your soul, your eternity. It costs you everything. Notice verse 16, the contrast Ruth is. Ruth clung to Naomi. Ruth is not going to leave Naomi. Naomi tells her, go on, go back with your sister-in-law. Do the sensible thing. But Ruth is adamant, I am going with you, whatever the cost. I am going to come with you. Notice her reply in verses 6, 16 and 17. But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me." Ruth is wholeheartedly committed to going with Naomi. She is loyal to Naomi, whatever the cost. She says, "I will go with you." Ruth, she leaves her homeland, her family, her possible inheritance. Ruth gives up everything to go with Naomi. She truly doesn't want to leave Naomi. Ruth, she truly does love Naomi. We see against all the odds, Ruth, she puts her faith in the Lord Jesus. She puts her faith in the living God. She lost her husband, she lost her brother-in-law, and now her sister-in-law is gone, and her mother-in-law is telling her to go back. But she chooses to trust in God. This isn't just a loving friendship, but Ruth is going to be a part of God's people. She switches citizenship from Moab to Israel. And this could be because of Naomi's words at the end of verse 13. "No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has turned against me." How on earth does that show Ruth to trust in the true God? Let's think for a second. What is Naomi actually saying here? Naomi acknowledges that God is the one who has allowed all this pain to happen. Notice Naomi sees God as the sovereign ruler who is in control of her life. Naomi reminds us that everything under heaven is governed by God who is enthroned. God allowed all Naomi's sufferings. God is the one who ordains the circumstances of life. Naomi realizes that God has allowed this calamity to come upon her. But not only that, look at how she responds to this heartbreaking situation. She decides to go back to him. Naomi has decided to go back to Israel, which is her returning to the Lord. Returning to the promised land is a picture of repentance. Let's just ponder this for a moment. Naomi, she feels bitter. She feels heartbroken for her loss, but she knows that God is faithful. She knows she needs to return to him. Naomi, she's in a similar situation to Job, and she responds similar to Job. Even though suffering, pain, and trouble has come upon her, Naomi is going back to God. This is most likely the reason Ruth goes with her. Ruth sees a woman utterly broken by the hurt of the world, yet she holds firm to her grip of God. Even though it's hard, even though he's in control, allowing all the pain, Naomi returns to him, and Ruth, she sees this and follows. Today, as Christians, isn't this a picture of our lives today when suffering comes? God is sovereign over all things. God is sovereign over our pain. God is sovereign over our brokenness. God is sovereign over death, disease, cancer, famine, earthquakes, wars. God can stop any of these, and God can allow these too. Are we willing to count the cost, like Naomi and like Ruth? Are we willing to serve and love and cling to God who holds this world in his hands? Romans 8, 28 and 29 helps. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Notice these verses. It isn't that God is working everything together so that we'll have a comfortable life. It's not that God only allows good to fall on our lives. This is God's purpose in all our brokenness, all our pain, all our struggles. He's working them together for our good, for the good of those who love him. But what is our good? Notice verse 29. It answers it for us. Our good is that we may be conformed to the image of Christ. That means all our sufferings, all our pain, everything God puts into our lives, he's put it in for a purpose, to make us more like his son Jesus. And I don't discount sufferings as nothing, and neither does God. And we should mourn and grieve, and we will have questions towards God. It's important, like Naomi, to let our questions and feelings out to others so that we don't grow hardened to the Lord within us, within ourselves. Even though our thoughts may seem wrong, we should let them out to a known, trusted believer. But when we are in our sufferings, in our pain, we must remember our lives are not about us. This life is not about our loved ones. Our lives are all about Jesus. God is on the throne. God knows what he's doing. God can't learn anything. God is never surprised. God is never frustrated. God never sleeps. God never struggles. God, he sees our pain, and God cares for us. God is working when we cannot see. And God's purposes are higher than our purposes. God is good, kind, and faithful. But we've got to count the cost. If we want to follow Jesus, we must be people who love God no matter what happens in this life. We must be willing to follow him even if calamity, suffering, and pain enter our lives. This is costly, but Jesus is worth it. Jesus is worth suffering for. We must call ourselves to be people who say with our lives, God, whatever you bring into my life, I will follow and trust you. This is tough, as we see with Naomi and Ruth, but they return back to Bethlehem in pain. Committing to Jesus is costly, but also committing to Jesus can be painful. We see that especially with Naomi. Notice the final point, verses 19 to 22, resentful return. Back in 2018, I remember I was working on a building site, and during the building project, I was cutting some metal, and as I was cutting this metal, a little piece of metal flew into my eye. I should have been wearing goggles. But at the time, it was painful for a minute or two, and then it felt normal, and I carried on with the job. But a few days later, my eye suddenly became very painful, and I ended up in A&E. As my eye was being examined, the nurse said, we've got to numb it, and then we've got to put a needle into your eye and pull out the metal. As I heard that, I wasn't too pleased that that was the way they did it. But I knew that if I didn't do that, the consequences would be greater. I knew that it was the right thing to do to have this metal removed, even though it seemed like a painful procedure. Obviously, Naomi's pain is far more severe than a little piece of metal in my eye. But Naomi, too, she knew she had to return to the Lord, even though it was painful, even though it was a painful process. She knew it was the right thing to do. She had to go through and return to the Lord. As we hit verses 19 to 22, Naomi, she returns to Bethlehem. We see here that she's in pain because of her circumstances, but she knows it's right to return to the Lord. The whole town is stirred because of their return. Firstly, the town would be thinking, where is Elimelech? And where are her two sons? And they'd also be thinking, why is Naomi with a Moabite woman? Notice Deuteronomy 23, verse 3, says, no Ammonite or Moabite or any of their descendants may enter the assembly of the Lord, not even in the 10th generation. We see here that there's a law against Ruth. What is she doing here, the people will ask. She shouldn't be amongst us. The question is, how did Ruth go from joining Moab to Israel, since there was a law against her? I think it's best understood through the gospel. We as people have a law against us. We have the Ten Commandments that tell us, you're not good enough, you're a sinner. And because of this law, we cannot come near to God and be made right with God. We're separated But God, in his grace and mercy, has opened the door for our sins to be forgiven through Jesus. Jesus, he bore our sin on the cross. And now Jesus says, come to me and be forgiven. Jesus has opened the door and he says, bring your sin, bring your mess, and I will make you right with God. That's how we come to God. And Ruth joined the people of God the same way, through the mercy of God. But how does Naomi respond to the people? Look at verses 20 to 21. Naomi explains, yes, I've come back with no husband, no sons, and I am empty. I have nothing, but I am back because the Lord has brought me back. And often God has to humble and empty us so that we will turn back to him and depend upon him alone. This can be a painful process. But notice the last verse of the chapter. So Naomi returned from Moab, accompanied by Ruth the Moabite, her daughter-in-law, arriving in Bethlehem as the barley harvest was beginning. What Naomi doesn't realize is that Ruth the Moabite stood right next to her, is going to bring her much blessing. And look at that, the famine is over, the barley harvest was beginning. We started the chapter with famine, and the chapter seems to go from bad to worse, but here at the end, we have a hint of hope. But we still end chapter 1 with a great need. These two women, they've returned to Bethlehem, but they've got no husband, no males to protect them and raise up offspring. These women are in great danger. Israel is in turmoil. Men do what they seem right in their own eyes. We leave chapter 1 with a question. How will these women cope in Israel? What will happen to them? If you want to find out, read the rest of Ruth. But as we close today, today's passage has outlined us with two main struggles the Christian faces on their way to glory. Temptations and trials. We see Elimelech running after the pleasure and ease of the world, and we see Naomi bombarded with painful struggles. Looking into our own lives, could it be you here today, and your life is like Elimelech's? You've gone away from God. You've departed from God because you've seen grass greener on the other side. If that's you here today, come back to God. Come back to him just like Naomi and Ruth did. He will receive you back. He will forgive you if you come to him. Don't put this off till you feel better. Just look at Naomi. She was bitter. She felt like she had nothing, yet she came back to God in her pain. Repent, turn back to God. He is the kind Father, willing to forgive and bring you back to himself. Just come to him. Don't fear. Come to him and receive forgiveness. And on the other hand, maybe you're somebody who has had much pain in your life, a suffering, a disease, a death, and that's caused you to neglect God. If that's caused you to feel anger towards God, and it can cause us to feel anger towards God for allowing it to happen, I urge you today to come back to the Father. He sees your pain, and he understands it. Just like Naomi, come back to God with your pain, with your mess. Return to God, who is the Lord, the faithful God. Come to him and say, God, I don't understand why this happened. I don't understand why you allowed it. This is painful, but please, God, help me to trust you. How do we see the gospel in this passage? How do we see Jesus in this passage, in this Old Testament? We see the gospel all over this passage. We see ourselves like Elimelech. We are all people who have decided to go our own way. We've decided God's way isn't best. I know best. And we're also like Ruth. We're enemies of God, far away from God. But where do we see Jesus? In this passage, we come across disobedience and tragedy. In the New Testament, the greatest disobedience and tragedy we see is 2,000 years ago when they decided to crucify a man. The ultimate disobedience and tragedy was when Jesus was hung on a cross for no reason. Yet God used and determined that this disobedience and tragedy would be the source of salvation, forgiveness, and eternal life to all who believe in Jesus. Jesus suffered on the cross so that we wouldn't have to suffer for all eternity. Jesus' sufferings, they are our glory, our strength, and our hope. Remember, when suffering comes into your life, it's for a purpose. God used the greatest tragedy and disobedience for the saving of many souls. If you're a Christian, when you're suffering, whatever it is, it will be used for your good and God's glory. And remember this, God is faithful. God is kind. God is good. He can be trusted. Amen. Let's now come and sing in closing as we come and stand together to sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. With some words from the Bible. Let's close. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen.